Welcome again. Today we've come to look at the applications of stem cells in the treatment of degenerative disease. Specifically, taking a look at how stem cells have been applied to treat Stargardt's disease. Stem cells are cells that have the power to produce more of themselves, but to differentiate and to become other cell types. Differentiation involves the expression of some genes, but not others. The capacity of stem cells to divide and to differentiate along different pathways is necessary in embryonic development, and this is what makes stem cells suitable for therapeutic uses. When life begins, a sperm cell fertilizes an egg cell to produce a zygote. This zygote in the human body has the potential to go on to form all of the extra embryonic membranes that set the stage for development, the placenta, the amnion, the chorion, and also to then allow the fetus to develop all the complex tissues of the body, including 220 cells. This very first cell from which life begins is all powerful. It is totipotent because it possesses the capacity to form a new organism, including all the cell types of the body. This fertilized egg or zygote then goes on to divide by mitosis to form a ball of a few cells called the morula. At the 2-cell stage, the 4-cell stage, and even up to the 8-cell stage, these cells can be separated, and each one possesses the capacity to go on to develop independently into a new human being. In other words, all of these cells are totipotent. But once the embryo begins to develop further to form the blastocyst, which consists of an outer layer or trophoblast, has now taken on the role of forming the extra embryonic membranes. And the cells within this hollow ball, or the inner cell mass, they are the ones that possess the capacity to form all of the other cell types of the body, minus the extra embryonic membranes. These cells are known as pluripotent, because they can form all of the cell types of the body, but they cannot on their own give rise to a new organism. When we speak of embryonic stem cells, it is really these cells of the inner cell mass of the blastocyst that we speak of, for they have the capacity to develop and to differentiate into all of the cell types of the human body. And if an embryonic stem cell is removed and put into the right culture, it will propagate itself and remain in the embryonic stem cell stage. So how then can embryonic stem cells be used in the treatment of Stargardt's disease? Stargardt's disease is an eye disorder, otherwise known as a retinopathy, where the cells of the retina are unable to carry out their functions effectively and vision progressively deteriorates. Stargardt's typically shows up in the teen years in most patients. It's brought about mainly by the presence of a recessive allele of the ABCA4 gene, which is responsible for the production of a transmembrane protein that regulates active transport in some of the tissues of the eye. If this protein is not functioning properly, then a substance known as lipofuscin accumulates in the retinal pigment epithelium, and this leads to progressive degeneration of the retinal epithelial cells and then the cones, which give vision. And vision gradually begins to deteriorate. So how then can embryonic stem cells be used to treat Stargardt's disease? Well, once the cells of the inner cell mass have been put into a culture, then biologists can figure out what factors need to be introduced into this culture to allow the undifferentiated embryonic stem cells to begin to differentiate into retinal pigment epithelium. And once this formula was discovered, then it was possible to produce retinal pigment epithelium sheets and to introduce them into Stargardt's patients. This was achieved for the first time in 2010, and it was a great breakthrough for the application of embryonic stem cells in the treatment of degenerative diseases. But the use of these embryonic stem cells does not come without some issues. First of all, the tissue generated from the embryonic stem cells is not a genetic match with the patient receiving the transplant. So there could be the issue of immunogenicity. The very use of an embryo is a highly controversial topic. For where does this embryo come from? And to examine this, we need to go have a look at IVF, in vitro fertilization. IVF is a procedure that's been around for almost 40 years, being carried out for the first time in 1978. The purpose of in vitro fertilization is to allow the sperm and the egg to come together in lab conditions to allow fertilization to happen, and then to replace the fertilized egg into the female reproductive system to allow development. It was developed to allow infertile couples to have the opportunity to bear children of their own. But because of the efficiency of in vitro fertilization and the fact that it is very difficult to get fertilization to happen in the first place, and secondly to get implantation, IVF clinics need to produce multiple fertilized eggs for each patient. And what this does is it creates leftover embryos, possible human life forms, which are left in petri dishes in the lab, frozen or disposed of. But when research began into human embryonic stem cells, this provided a great source of embryonic stem cells. Yet, the use remained controversial, for the status of this early embryo remained questionable, and the question was asked whether or not one life was being taken to bring relief of suffering to another. Another topic that's related to this therapeutic use of embryonic stem cells is somatic cell nuclear transfer, carried out for the first time in frogs in 1958 and then replicated in sheep in the 1990s. Today, we understand that the nucleus of a somatic cell can possibly replace the nucleus of a fertilized egg, allowing for a clone of this donor cell to develop. So in the case of the treatment of Stargardt's disease, to avoid immune rejection, it could be possible for the very patient to donate a skin cell, let's say, into an enucleated oocyte, allowing that enucleated oocyte to generate an embryo and then harvest those stem cells to produce a retinal pigmented sheep. But in the particular case of Stargardt's disease, which is usually genetic, treatment in this way with therapeutic cloning would not be the right way to go, for the very genes which reside in the somatic cell will then express themselves again and allow for the symptoms of Stargardt's disease to return in time. But perhaps it might be possible to relieve the immune rejection issues by allowing for a sibling donor to provide a somatic cell, remove its nucleus, place it into a fertilized egg, stimulate it to develop, allow an embryo to develop, then harvest embryonic stem cells, treat it with growth factors, and allow for the development of a retinal pigmented sheet, which is then placed into the eye of the sibling recipient. In this case, because of the close genetic match, you would have a cure for Stargardt's disease and also a relief of the problem of immunogenicity. This somatic cell nuclear transfer leads to the production of a clone of the human donor. And if this cell were allowed to go on to develop in vivo in a woman's uterus, it would give rise to a clone of the donor. Of course, human cloning is currently seen as highly unethical and is unlikely to happen in the near future. But the production of embryos, which are potential human beings, will allow for therapeutic cloning. And where diseases do not have a genetic basis, the very patient can donate cells, which in turn would generate embryos to produce the cultures that would then generate the cells required. But is there a way to escape the whole issue of having to produce an embryo, a potential life form, and to then take that life form apart. Is there a way to get away from the embryonic stem cell? This was the question that was asked by two Japanese researchers, and by 2007, Shinya Yamanaka and his team created induced pluripotent stem cells. But the induced pluripotent stem cell is the subject of another lesson.